Welcome to the STARS program, seniors taking active roles in society. And now, here's your host, Anita Finley.
So we have another author. Authors are great. They spend a lot of time developing what they want to write. Then sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. But with this gentleman, it certainly worked because he just loved the military. And he decided he would write something about what he did. Death in the Midnight Sky, it's really flying the mighty gunship in combat. And it's a memoir. So welcome, Joe Berardino. Welcome to our show.
Thank you very much.
So tell us, why don't you just tell us a little bit about how you even decided that you were going to write. I mean, you had such a great career. Why did you want to turn it into a book?
I felt like I owed a responsibility to a guy who was a mentor of mine in Vietnam. I met him as a very young man, and he guided me through going to college, and he inspired me to try to go further. I was enlisted at the time, and I quit high school. So my friend Ron had great ambitions and great aspirations, and he kept telling me, you can do a lot better. You need to go to college and continue your education and become an officer. He said, what are you going to do when you get out of the Air Force? You're going to be a gunner on a Budweiser truck in Hialeah? And I said, no, I hadn't really thought about it. And he said, well, you're going to go to college. So he enrolled us in college at night, and we worked on it. Unfortunately, Ron died in Vietnam, and so I felt like I owed a tribute to him and that I had to write as much of his story as I knew.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, I saw that Ron was very important to you, and that's beautiful that you did that for him. But you really have had quite a career. I mean, let's just even talk about when you were on this gunship, because that wasn't when you were a colonel. That was after.
Oh, no, no.
I was
a young airman and a young sergeant. And so you just flew your tour in Vietnam. I volunteered, and I flew my tour. When I came back, then I started going full-time hard to college. And then the Air Force had a program, Airman's Education and Commissioning Program. And they sent me to Michigan State, and then as an engineer. And I graduated and became an officer and served for another 30 years. Actually, 25 after that.
I remember in your book, though, whenever you tried to talk about being an officer, the enlisted men, they didn't like that, did they? What is that?
Well, there's always a group of people that kind of a subculture that thinks that the officers are different or they're uppity or they act too smart. And, you know, in Vietnam, that's why the Army had fragging. You know, over 100 officers were killed and fragged by their own men because they were perceived as being, thinking that they were upper class and being arrogant. So there's a strata of enlisted men who think that to become an officer is not worthwhile. My father was one of them. He felt the same way. He was somewhat insulted that I became an officer.
Isn't that interesting? I know that my husband, of course, as you read his book, but he came from a little poor family, and he was very excited to become a first lieutenant. That he, you know, it's, I guess it just depends on who you are and where you are, what you're doing. But maybe it was because he was flying B-17. Do you think that made a difference as a pilot?
Well, he was with almost all officers. He was not with the enlisted men. I was with the enlisted men while I was enlisted. So I only got with the officers when we flew. The rest of the time I lived in the barracks with the sergeants and the airmen, and spent most of my life with them. All my schools were with them and everything else.
Yeah, so that was very different. Well, but let's just get back to then Vietnam, because I do have some friends who were in Vietnam, and they said when they came back, they were not really treated very well. Did you find that happening to you too?
Not so much. Maybe I'm oblivious to most of that stuff, but I was still on active duty, and I was still flying gunships. When I went to Michigan State, so maybe the people who went back to civilian life, they saw a lot more of that. I didn't. I was on a base and everything else. But when I went to Michigan State, they had protests. We had protest marches. I went to some of the protest demonstrations. So I saw it, but it didn't really affect me much. I was maybe oblivious to it.
Yeah. Okay, so now you went through, you were young, you were in the war, then you came out, then you went to college, and you became an officer. Tell us what you did as an officer.
When I was first commissioned, I was an engineer, and my first assignment was Sacramento Air Logistics Center in California, and I engineered packaging engineering, different things that the Air Force needed work on. And then I went to the headquarters at Wright-Patterson, where I worked on all kinds of different engineering projects. While I was there, I didn't like the laboratory very much. I was an engineer, but I'm really much more of an extrovert. I like people more. Engineers tend to be very closed people and kind of into themselves. They love machines and they love oscilloscopes and, you know, everything else. I liked people more, and I didn't really like the laboratory. So I was offered an opportunity to go to grad school at the University of Tennessee if I would become a transportation officer. So I did. I took that, and I went to the University of Tennessee and brought my family, my wife and three children. And we went to the University of Tennessee, and from there we went to Guam, where I became a squadron commander in a transportation squadron in a B-52 squadron.
That's very exciting stuff. So now you're really back in it again in a different way.
Yeah.
But so the military, of course, has held very important aspects of your life, as you think about. A lot of people want to just get out. But you didn't mind staying in and then rising to be a colonel, which was pretty high.
Yeah, after that, my family and I went to England. My ex-wife was English, so we went back to England. We spent 4 happy years there. I commanded a mobile aerial port squadron, and from there I went to the Pentagon and spent 5 years there in the office of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Colin Powell was my chairman.
No kidding.
Yeah. And then from there to Rhein-Main, Germany, where I commanded the biggest aerial port in Europe. And a really fine assignment. I really loved it. But, of course, my brains and my heart was always with the gunship and the young folks who were flying the gunship, so I always loved that.
Explain to our audience, please. Let me just tell everybody again. I'm talking with this great guy, Joe Berardino, Death in the Midnight Sky, flying the mighty guns, Mighty gunship in combat. And it's a memoir. And that means that there are items that are in fiction, but there are many things that are true, right? That's what a memoir is. But not everything is exact.
It's as close as I can make it.
Oh, really?
The only fictitious thing is names and places. I might have changed some names because the publisher wanted me to make sure that they couldn't be sued. But it's as close to being everything as true as I can make it.
And the one thing I said to Joe is, how did you remember all this stuff? And he said that a lot of the people who've read this, who knew you, said, how did you remember it? Is it just because you have a photographic mind, or you made a lot of notes?
No, I had a lot of notes, and I still have many of the people in the book are still friends of mine.
Oh, that's fabulous.
The guy in the book called Ace, who was my pilot, is a retired Brigadier General Montgomery, and he lives in Virginia, and I still go see him. My co-pilot, who's called Zumi, is a retired Brigadier General who lives in Virginia, and I still visit him.
Fantastic.
Half of the other enlisted people on the airplanes belong to the same Spooky Brotherhood, which is a gunship organization of all those people. Spooky was our call sign, as you know from the book.
Yes.
And so the Spooky Brotherhood meets every year, and then whenever I have questions, I go to them and I said, you remember that night that when this happened? And so we have very different perspectives, but I try to sort it out and try to be as honest as I can.
Yeah, it's really so beautiful. Well, I have no idea what this plane was like inside, what the gunship is like. What is it like inside? I knew what the B-17 was, very tiny. Is this big and wide?
It's smaller than the B-17. B-17 had 4 engines. This is smaller. It has 2 engines. It has big, big wings like the B-17. It was called the C-47. Civilians called it DC-3. The DC-3, it was one of the first commercial airplanes, but the model in the military had 3 guns out of the left side, 3 miniguns, these 6-barrel Gatling guns, and we carried 21,000 rounds of ammunition. But it's very small. We had 7 members on the crew, and so we flew every night and defended American targets.
Right, and how high did it go?
We generally flew at 3,000 feet. When we're on target and shooting, but it was a very dangerous air altitude. As you know,
yes.
Many of my colleagues were killed because we had to fly so low that, with a small arm ammunition, you can shoot the airplane down, and many were shot down.
Yeah, and some couldn't believe you were going to go so low. That was like, how can we do that? And I know that people just said, well, that's what we're going to do because we've got to get them.
Right, because in general, we only flew when the Marines or the Army were under attack. When the enemy's attacking the Army, then we would go and fly above them, we fly in a left-hand circle and shoot our guns at the side at the enemy.
I also love the motto that we don't leave anyone behind.
Never leave a buddy behind. And so you know there was a couple of missions. One mission I saw seven helicopters shot down trying to save one Marine. What happened was there was a big battle. The Marines all got on their helicopters to evacuate because they were leaving. And on the way back, they do roll call in the helicopters because you get in whatever helicopter you can. You know, you don't know where your buddies are. And did the roll call, and there was somebody missing. So we were flying over him, and the Marine commander called my pilot and said, "We're going back. Somebody's missing." And we had to go back. And so it was a hell of a fight. The Marines fought tooth and nail, and seven helicopters were shot down. We got everybody out, and we found the guy who, as you know, if you read the book, we found the guy who was missing and got him home, too.
That is that really a slogan in the military?
Absolutely. Never leave a body behind. And that doesn't mean alive. If it's a body, even his body. We'll go back to the last man. We'll fight to make sure that we get every single one back. We'll never leave anyone there, ever.
That's really...
American knows that. Every fighting man knows that, and that's a wonderful attribute because, you know... He's never going to quit because he knows they're coming back for him. He's never going to stop.
Right. I just loved it. I mean, it was very exciting for me to read this. You know, I start out trying to do it very quickly because I have to have things I have to read, but I really couldn't put it down. It was really very well done. And the fact you're a very, very good writer, too.
Thank you.
So that's skills that I guess you learned in your profession. You know, as a commander, you had to learn how to really write well.
Yeah, but writing... in the military is significantly different than trying to write a book or trying to write a memoir. And when I tried to write, I tried to write it like a novel so that it was good to read and fun to read and exciting.
Well, it came from your heart, which I thought was very important.
Exactly.
So now you've written your book. Now I know you're writing some other things because someone like you just can't stop.
Yeah, exactly.
Will it be military or what will it be about?
I have right now I have a couple. I'm writing a book about women's lib.
You're a man after my own heart. Women's liberation.
Yeah, I just went to... Erica Jong was here last week. You remember Erica Jong when
you
were a kid?
Of course, I remember.
Fear of Flying?
Yeah, I remember that book.
Boy, she's amazing. She's got a new book, Fear of Dying. And so she spoke at FAU campus the other day, and I went and...
In Boca?
Yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah. And she's an amazing woman anyway, but a fierce women's liber, you know. And I have three granddaughters, and so I dearly want to make sure that I leave them... some tribute to womanhood. And my mother was a incredible woman's liber long before her day. As a matter of fact, she had this theory about the GI Bill. You know, nowadays we say the GI Bill was this wonderful thing. And she says, you know, it really put women back 50 years because all the women who were smart enough to go to college, when the men got out of the military, they all got to go for free and they knocked us all out of school.
I did not know that.
And the women who were Rosie the Riveter, that's the theme of my new book. Rosie the Riveter actually won World War II. It was the work of the women on the production line making the weapons that the Russians, the Americans, and the English used that won the war. But as soon as the war was over, the men came back and Rosie the Riveter couldn't go to college. And Rosie the Riveter had to go home and take care of the family.
And that's interesting you say that because I know we lived in Paterson, New Jersey, and my mother worked
That's where my mother was from.
And my mother worked in the Wright...
Aircraft factory.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I do remember that she did that, and she was always a very strong woman. But you are right what you said, that the women, they do what they have to do, and they don't think about it as being, you know, as being a liberation. They just do it.
Exactly.
And so you had a great mother. How long did your mom live?
She died when I was in Germany in 1991.
But so she lived a long
life. Yeah. She was from almost the same place as you. She was the valedictorian of... Bayonne High School in 1921.
Well, I only lived there till I was seven. And then we moved to Miami Beach.
Okay. You were lucky?
Yeah, that's what happened. They moved there, and there were not very many places to move to. But I want to tell you something that my husband had told me that the Air Force, or maybe you did too, that Miami Beach, no, this was later for you, the Miami Beach was the place that they all went to do their training. And he remembers Miami Beach with all the guys that went on the beaches. And
that's where my father trained. My father was from Jersey City, and then he during the war, he was going to be a gunner on B-29s. So he came to Miami Beach. All the training schools were down here somewhere in Florida. And he said, when the war was over, I'm never going back to New Jersey. And so he went, got my mother and the kids, and moved to Miami, and we never moved back.
What a great story. story. So where did you grow up? Here?
Miami.
I think you told me that, as a matter of fact.
And it was wonderful. I went to Hialeah High School and Jackson High School and all different places in Miami.
Oh, my goodness. This is just amazing. So many of the guys did that. Once they saw this was like living in paradise.
Oh, yeah. They left a freezing cold, New Jersey and New York. They were never going back.
When my husband flew his 35 missions, they then asked him, did he want to do some other things in the air? And he pretty much didn't. They were going to have him fly into Alaska, make a lot of those flights. So what they gave him was too bad. In Southern California, he then became the officer who arranged all the shows. Bob Hope, Gardner.
That's
that was terrible. That's
the
what
USO
he did.
Shows, yeah.
The USO show. So here at age 21 or something, he was doing something like that.
Oh, that's
so,
been wonderful.
So, but you talked about going to college. So he really didn't have any, he didn't do very well in high school. And so when he didn't even know what college was, he said. So he went to Stanford and they laughed at him. They said, there's no way. But they took him in at Berkeley. On a,
another
probation.
Great school, though, really.
And he did very well there.
So by then, by the time you matured and you've been through combat and been in the Air Force, same as me. I was miserable in high school, but then all of a sudden you get a little older, a little smarter. You see that the alternative is to get your ass in an airplane and get shot at. I think you want to go to college.
Yeah, right. And so many of you did that, and you became, really great citizens of the United States. So now you are going to be you're going to be an author. I mean, you're going to be an author over and over and over again, aren't you? Do you work with a writers group or you do this on your own?
I have a couple of writers group. I have one in Boca that is six, seven Jewish ladies, and they're wonderful. A couple of them are very accomplished. They have 8, 9, 10 books. I have also a book group called Ink Bloods in Davie, and then there's a big writers group in Wellington, and so I go to lots of different writers groups. You write and you trade whatever chapter you're writing, and they help you. They tell you that this is not so good or that's good, and we work together on all kinds of things.
This is great. It's so lovely having someone like you on our radio show. As I said, I love to have authors on the radio show, and I just want to tell everybody this is Joe Berardino, and Joe is the person who wrote the book. And I have the book right here. It's very interesting. It's a major, you can look in our magazine and you can look at the new issue. I'm just going to tell everybody, if you're listening, why don't you go to page 8, and it's the book review, and it's Death in the Midnight Sky, Fighting the Mighty Gunship in Combat, and it's a memoir. And it's really worth your getting and buying it and reading it and passing it along. Find maybe another military guy and give it to them, because even if they weren't a pilot, but you were in the air at the time. It was the Air Force, and my husband was in it was the Air Corps, and your father was probably the Air Corps.
Air Corps, of course, and it changed in 1948. Your husband's book talks about when it changed and became a separate branch,
right?
But anybody who was in Vietnam saw the gunship. The gunship, we flew in a left-hand circle around every place we were fighting. And we fired, and every fifth round was a tracer, so it looked like a big stream of bullets coming out of the sky. So everybody knows about it. Everybody was in Vietnam, saw it. Every night we were flying, and every night they all saw it. So everybody was in Vietnam would love to see the book and learn about it.
Yeah. Did you have a choice of where you would fly? I mean, what you would fly when you were in the Air Force?
No, it was there was only one. As an enlisted guy, there's very few airplanes. Pilots have a different perspective.
I see.
As an enlisted guy, no, I signed up for one program. That was the program I signed up for.
And so your life really has been, it's been very creative, but on the other hand, you were pretty focused in one thing, the military.
Exactly.
And how do you feel, and this is not political, but how do you feel today? Do you feel that the military is doing the best that they could as when you were in there?
Absolutely. I think they're doing a marvelous job. The politics aside, I think it's wonderful. And I think the new presidential support of the military is phenomenal. I'm not sure I'm a big fan of a military parade, but what the heck? Yeah. I don't know. But I think they're doing a great job, and God bless them.
Yeah, so now we know a bit. Now, that's what I wanted to get at. So trauma. We know that, I never heard about trauma with people like you or my husband or people. But now the kids are coming back, and they're really they're really suffering from this. Why didn't you all suffer from it? Or did you and we didn't know?
I don't think we're allowed to. The movie Patton. When they say somebody in the hospital has they call it combat fatigue in those days. You know, I can't go back in there. It's going to kill me. Well, we all felt that way sometimes, you know, I think. There's a place in my book where when my friend got killed, I told my commander I was never going to fly again. But the next day I went and flew. I think there are times we all felt like that, but I don't think it was accepted. It was, you're not allowed. Soldier up. Pull up your pants, put on your big boy pants, and get on and get in the airplane. And the soldiers need you and the Marines need you, and you got to go fight.
At the time that you were flying, were there female pilots?
Not in combat.
Not in combat. But there are now.
There are now. I met one, a girl who got the Silver Star in Iraq. She was a helicopter pilot, and Silver Star is very high medal, of course. And she won the Silver Star in Iraq for heroism flying her helicopter.
And also the African Americans. You know, it's funny. I was walking my dog, and an African American came up to me because he had heard about my husband, and he wanted to tell me how proud I should be of him and all. And he said he was in the military, but he actually, I think he flew. There was the black. What was that called? I saw that movie. The black pilots.
Oh, yeah. Tuskegee Airmen.
Yes, the Tuskegee.
That was World War II. After World War II, you know, we were totally integrated. We had them in our squadron, black, white, pink, yellow, everything.
But at that time, so he said something, and I think I added that. I may have added that in your article, your review, because people can't judge, you know, whether you're white or you're black and how good you're going to be. And now I think it's the same thing with women.
That's exactly right.
You know, and because you see a lot of women on the police forces, and they... You know, that
seemed to me to do just as well as anyone else.
But I guess that's just a fable in a sense. We just never thought about that before.
I think that we're learning as human beings, you know, that any prejudice against another human being doesn't seem to work right.
No. You know, in Israel, the women, of course, were always in the military.
Of course.
And that's what they expect to do, to defend. So I think that
When Golda Meir is your premier, you know, or your prime minister, you don't have much choice, you know.
Yep. No, that's true. And so you should be so proud of yourself. Let's see, I forget how many pages was there in your book. 300-something? I forget now when I'm going to look at that. I'm going to look again. I'm trying to hold up this for, I think it was 300-something, wasn't it?
295.
I knew it was about 300. 295. You know, you had a lot of rewrites, I'm sure, because I've lived with someone who has written a lot of books in it. And it's, it's funny, you have writers' clubs. And they can just trash your book in a nice way and say, you got to rewrite that whole thing because it's right.
And it always makes you better. The good thing is it always makes you better. And they're right. It needs to be done and done and done. And when you read about the great writers, it's amazing how hard they work at some of these things. It's just months and months and months and months. And so if it's going to be good, it's like anything else in life. If you want to make it good, you're going to have to work hard at it.
So did you sleep at night while you were writing this book?
You know, I think that in writing, that the subconscious mind does a heck of a lot of the work. And I would go to sleep at night and try to remember the next mission and wake up in the morning and have a good feel for it. And I could outline what it was. Every chapter was mostly written at night in my sleep.
That's great. And that was the other thing. I've interviewed a lot of authors, and some of them, they don't outline. Some of them use yellow stickies. What do you use?
Now I try to outline, I wake up in the morning, try to outline, I get up early in the morning and just start writing, and then you end up throwing away lots of what you write, but on the other hand, it doesn't matter as long as it becomes good.
My husband was an urban planner, and so he always had things all over his office, you know, with this and the yellow slips and that, to give him an idea of where he wanted to go, but sometimes he'd take it off, he said, no, I don't want to go there.
Right.
But you have to be imaginative, you have to be creative to be an author.
You have to be, like your husband, organized, too. You have different ideas you want to put in certain chapters and certain paragraphs, and you have to kind of organize all that.
And so did you, and you probably tried like a lot of people. That's why we love book reviews, because so many people write wonderful books. And unless you have someone who really knows the publishers and has their foot in the door, it doesn't get published. And I've seen so many people with all their books in boxes sitting there, and it's such a shame. So we're really glad that people can publish on their own and get it done.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you.
Because you can see yourself that if you didn't get this done, it was all in your mind, it wouldn't have been fair. How many people you have affected now with this book, and will be, as people read about it here and listen to your shows and do things, you're really affecting a lot of people with that energy that you put into this book.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, that's how I think about all this. And so your next book, that's going to be an interesting thing on the women's liberation movement. Now we have this whole new thing called, what is it called, Me Too or something? Yeah.
I'm writing about, during the Civil War, it's halfway military. There were between 400 and 700 women who dressed as men and fought in battle.
You're kidding.
So Frances Clayton is the one I'm using as my heroine. And there are many, many, many. And she was in 17 battles, wounded four times. Her husband was killed on the battlefield. So she's my main character. It's going to be historical fiction. So I'm going to invent stories around
this.
That.
Well,
yeah, yeah. She's
we're
brilliant.
We're going to get you off Facebook Live right now. But we certainly have enjoyed this. And I love the fact you're going to do so. I did not know that fact. The Civil War, they wanted to fight, and they dressed up like men.
Exactly.
Great, great story. Well, thanks for being here, Joe.
Hey, thank
really.
You very much. Yeah. I sincerely appreciate it.
Yeah, I really loved it myself.